Pastor Paul, Pastor Jeff.
See you again, my friend.
Sustai. We are in Cambodia right now. We've been here, I don't know, a couple days. It all blurs together because we had to, like, the first getting here was like 24 hours of nonstop travel. And then we got here and realized that they lost all of my bags. Not any of Pastor Paul's or Pastor Jeff's bags, just all of my bags, all of them, which was all of my camera gear, all of it, and all of my clothes, all of it. So I had the sweatpants that I was wearing and the lucky t-shirt that my wife so graciously stuck in my backpack. And that was all I had when we landed in 95 degree crazy humidity weather. So it's been really interesting because I actually just heard, we were walking back to the hotel maybe like an hour ago, and Pastor Paul told me that he got the text from Emily City saying school was canceled because of icy roads or something like that. And it's like 93 right now here, and it's just constant swamp butt here. I know you don't believe it, but the snow doesn't sound that bad right now. Yeah, it does. I'm all right. Never mind. You guys can have the snow. I don't miss the snow. The Lord's been really faithful. It's just been a trying couple of days, to be honest. So pray for us. We could use prayer. We would appreciate that, actually. But anyways.
We are one.
I won.
私たちは一人じゃない。
我们是第一吗?
We've missed.
We are what?
Perfect. The people here are like crazy drivers. Like, you're constantly almost getting hit by something. Especially like when I stand on that white, like, striped line in the middle. Like, I've almost gotten hit so many times. It's wild. Wonder if I can ghost this guy. All these Asian people wear like these thing, masks all the time. Oh, sorry. Sorry. I stepped on his ankle. He was not happy about it at all, but that is the price to pay. Look at all this. Sustai. Hello. Oh, that's awkward when you speak to them in Cambodian and they actually speak English. Strangers finding me on the street. Creeper, creeper, stranger danger, going left. These guys are handing out flyers for a party. We're not going to that party, boys. We're not going to your party. We're going to a Jesus party. That's the guy, that's Darth. He's always smiling, always smiling. YOLO. No thanks, I'm all right. No thanks, I do not want your Cambodian prostitute, which is what he just offered me. Asia's different, guys. It's different than Imlay City, by just a little bit. No, Akun. No, thank you, no weed, I'm good. I appreciate it though. They're so nice here, the locals. Always offering you weed. Gotta appreciate that. The kids here are so cute. Like, some of the cutest children I've ever seen. I haven't seen my kids yet, but to be honest, every baby I see looks like a Star Wars alien, so I don't have like super high hopes for like right when they come out, but they start to get cute as toddlers. Like my wife, for instance, she's not gonna like this, but not the cutest baby. She was cute, but she had the schnoz. Not the schnoz, the inverse schnoz, the reverse schnoz, the absence of schnoz. She was schnozless. Well, I wasn't that cute of a baby either, I don't remember. And both of us, you know, sort of panned out. Everybody looks at you when you're walking around with a camera in your face and a microphone on. We both panned out. Like, by the time we were toddlers, we were cute kids. She was a very, very cute little toddler. But then there was like that season of, you know, like soup, soups, hawk sauce, middle school age. You know what I mean? Like when you get to that fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, some of you may be in it right now. And here's, if you are, if you do find yourself in that awkward season, some people don't go through it. I did, my wife did. But if you find yourself in that season, I want to offer you some hope, all right? Because here's, for instance, here's myself. Well, here's my wife in that sort of really awkward middle school type season. The teeth and the big, giant, like, squid eyes. And she's beautiful now. I get it. Trust me. I married her. But we all go through awkward seasons. And here's me in that really, like, awkward phase. I kind of grew out of it. Like, there's still a lot of pieces of it that stuck with me. But I want to just give each of you hope, right? I want to give you hope right now. Here's what that girl grew into. This is the girl that I met. And all the ladies just said, amen. Amen, Pastor Schmieve. And all the dudes said, shut up. Don't you dare talk about my wife. Don't you dare, Aaron McIntosh. Keep your mouth shut. But I think a lot of times we're sort of stuck, afraid, when we're in these seasons that we don't enjoy, when we're stuck in something that we hate, when we're unable to break away from something that we want to break away from. A lot of times it actually makes us really fearful that we'll always be stuck. And that's kind of what I want to talk about tonight. I want to call it the progression of promise. If you don't know, I'm the young adults pastor and I pastor Progression, which is our young adults ministry. That's why they call me the young adults pastor. And where that came from is actually this phrase that it's not about perfection, it's about progression. And I felt like the Lord was really dealing with me for a season, still is, on this idea of perfectionism in my life, that I was always frustrated, still can be frustrated when I do any little thing that I know is not of God. And I don't mean it at all that this gives us license to sin. It doesn't mean that like sin is okay or that when we fail, we're just supposed to be like fine with it. That's not it. We seek the Lord, we find out where we went wrong, we ask Him to forgive us, and we ask Him how to not go about doing that same thing again. But the difference is, a lot of times I think when we fail, we walk around in this condemnation and hating ourselves, and we walk around in shame and guilt, and those are not the things that God designed for us. Like, that's not what He has for us. And I think a lot of times when we're stuck in this awkward season, and we know that God has promised us this promised land season, but we don't know how to get there. We don't know what the process is. We don't know how to step from ox sauce to the promised land. And there is this process of stepping over the Jordan River, like the Israelites had to do. They had to step over the Jordan River. And then they had to go through this process of possessing the land one nation at a time. And that's what I want to talk about tonight. You know, as each week, like Pastor Tyler was telling stories from being a middle schooler, and Pastor Dave was telling stories of being a high schooler, and it would be my job then technically to tell stories of being a young adult or a college age. And honestly, most of my memories in college had to do with Pastor Tyler, Pastor Luke, Haps, Pastor Dave some. Really, I have a lot of memories of Haps laying in my bed. Not with me. He would just like, I'd come back and he'd be just asleep in my bed. Just dead in my bed. Without my permission. Just, I'd be working and I'd think that he was sitting behind me like watching a movie or something. No, he's asleep in my bed. I wonder if I can find the photo. But one time I found him in my bed. What was it? He was wearing a Cookie Monster t-shirt out cold on a chocolate chip cookie. Fast asleep in my bed. Like melted a chocolate chip cookie into my mattress. So I have a lot of memories of that, but honestly, my most potent memory in college, like the thing that I, when I think about college, the thing that I like really think about the most, this is a cool street. Sorry, I'm gonna try to pay attention. The thing that I think about the most is Janelle. Like, Janelle, if you don't know our story, so I actually saw her on the, and we met on the very first day of our very first class of our very first year of college. So freshman year, our first class, 9:30 a.m. I think on a Thursday, general psychology. I saw this girl walk in the front of the classroom. I was sitting at the back, and I just sort of asked the Lord, like, I said, God, something seems interesting about that girl. I want to get to know her. And that was it. It was that simple. It wasn't, holy cow, that's the hottest thing I've ever seen. It was just like, she seems interesting. I just want to get to know her. And little did I know that the Lord was actually going to take me and her and put us together in a study group so I could get the digits. And so this kid's selling scorpions. It's a very strange place. But I ended up, you know, getting to know her. We became really good friends. That was freshman year. And then over the course of, 4 years, we didn't go on our first date until after our last final of senior year. So we spent 4 years of college getting to know each other. And that progression changed my life. I think I'm especially thinking about my wife because I miss my wife, like, a lot. Love you, baby. Miss you. Is everybody saying aw? You all said aw, didn't you? Okay, if you didn't, everybody on count of three right now. Make her feel good. Ready? One, two, three. Aw. Yeah, he's such a good husband. Yeah. You know, getting to know her, falling in love with her, that was a progression that obviously changed my life. I vividly remember the first time I saw her. I remember the first time we actually met. I remember the first time she held my hand. I want you to notice the phrasing that I just used there. Not the first time we held hands, the first time I held her hand. The first time she held my hand. Yeah. Yep. Yep. We were going through some Christmas exhibit, and I think the way she tries to tell the story is that, like, she was worried that I was going to get lost or something, but really she was just all about the shmeev. I don't blame her. She was just all about the shmeev. But I have all these memories as I went through college, really, about the progression of this relationship with this girl. And so, if you have your Bibles, if not, I'm gonna put it on the screen in this cut, but if you have your Bibles and you want to turn to Exodus 23. I'm gonna pause for a second so I can actually read this. No, I'm gonna try to read it while I'm walking and not get hit by a scooter. Think I can do it? Let's try. I'm gonna do it in the middle of the road too. No, I'm just kidding. Exodus 23, verse 27 to 30. It says, I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I'll make all your enemies turn their backs and run. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, Canaanites, and Hittites out of your way. But I will not drive them out in a single year, because the land would become desolate and the wild animals too numerous for you. Little by little, I will drive them out before you until you have increased enough to take possession of the land. I think it's really interesting as you begin to break down this scripture, the idea that the Lord had promised Israel the promised land, right? That's why they call it the Promised Land, because it was land that God had made an oath to Abraham saying that it would be theirs. So he had made this promise to these people. And then right before they're about to cross over the Jordan River, right before they're about to go in and take it. So they've been sitting on this promise for however many years at this point, you know, hundreds. They've been sitting on this promise waiting for its fulfillment. And the moment when they're about to step in and they're about to actually go take hold of the promise that God had made them, now all of a sudden, this is what God says to them. He says, you're going to go in and you're going to take possession of the land, and I'm going to do it for you. I'm actually going to go before you, and I'm going to drive out all of the peoples before you, and I'm going to send in the hornet before you. And I think it's interesting, like, that word hornet is only used three times in the whole Bible, and it's only in these stories as it's referring to them driving out these people groups. And it literally means hornets, and it could mean, you know, a spiritual force that God would use to, like, send people into confusion. But in Palestine, in this area, they actually have these, like, hornets on crack, like, not like our hornets, like these. That's a popo. He just whistled in my ear. they have these hornets that are like huge, and they actually go in these giant swarms, a lot like ours do, but they're like 2, 3, 4 times as large, something like that. And they sting and kill people, and like they can drive cows and horses mad, and like it sounds really, really crazy. And so God is actually telling them, I'm gonna send these things ahead of you. I'm gonna go take care of you. So here is your responsibility. Here's what I want you to do in this situation. I want you to actually be the ones that go in and inch by inch take the land. I thought it was really interesting that God said very specifically, when you go in, I don't want you to, you're not gonna take all of it at once. You're not gonna take all of it in a single year. Because if you took all of it in a single year, what would happen is, if they went in and they just went in and drove out all the nations in front of them, and they just emptied the land, what would happen is all of the wild animals that had been possessing the land up to that point would all of a sudden have no one to maintain them, and they would just go bug nuts. So this land that they used to have a bunch of different nations possessing, a bunch of different nations looking over, a bunch of different nations, you know, in there keeping the population down through hunting and through all these things, domesticating, these places that would have used to have a bunch of different people to actually maintain the land, God said, I'm not gonna drive out all of these nations in a year, because if I did, they wouldn't be serving the purposes that I had them there for in the first place. So I'm actually gonna allow these frustrations, these people that are there, who you know you don't want there, who you know aren't supposed to be there, I'm gonna allow these frustrations to stay there for a time to allow you to go through the process of trusting me, one nation at a time. And I think if we're honest, each of us has, we all walk through this process. We all walk through this process of, okay, we understand that the Lord has promised us something. We understand that the Lord is promising us something. Even if it's just salvation, freedom, like you are promised freedom. We are promised freedom, freedom from addiction, freedom from depression, freedom from, we're promised joy, we're promised peace. Like, we have so many of these things that we are promised, and I think a lot of the times what happens is, because we don't get them in the first year, because we don't have them in their fullness yet, because we don't walk in them the way we want to, because we don't walk in them yet the way we see in Scripture that we're capable of, because we're not quite there yet, I think it's quick for us, it's easy for us to write it off, say it's not real, to write it off and say, well, we'll never be there, to write it off and say, well, I'm just not capable, or, you know, there's some guys, there's some girls who they're capable of being free of that, or they're capable of having that joy, they're capable of having that peace, but not me. You don't know my story. Not me. You don't know my family. Like, oh my goodness. The missionary that we've been with this week, this guy, look him up. His name's Darth Lee, D-A-R-E-T-H. Last name, L-Y, Darth Lee. In the 1970s, a rogue communist party called the Khmer Rouge. If you've ever heard of the Killing Fields, that's where we're at right now, like Cambodia. We're going to see we've actually been in several of them that people were slaughtered in the 70s already. And in the 1970s, they rose to power and they just started slaughtering people. They killed, they estimate, between 2 and 3 million people. That was half the nation at the time in the 70s. This guy was 7 years old. 7 years old, and for 4 years he ended up in a prison labor camp, being tortured, being forced to work, having to eat bugs and leaves and sticks and anything he could to just survive for 4 years, until finally they actually opened up. They came in and they came in and they liberated the country, but that didn't mean that he was free. They still had to walk through these forests full of landmines, and he watched people die in front of him, and he had to walk over dead bodies to get, like, my point is, the dude has every reason coming out of that to not be joyful. No, thank you. To not have peace, to say, you know what, it's just not possible for me. Excuse me. I'm just not ever gonna be able to have what others have. You know, my dad died, and he thought his mom was dead, and ended up coming to the States as a refugee, and like, it would have been so easy for him to just say, you know what, I'm never gonna have that. And the dude is just the biggest smile all the time, joyful all the time. Like, people like that are so encouraging. Why? Because it makes us look at our own situation and go, okay, if they can, I can. And if you look at the story that I'm talking about today, this journey that the Lord was walking the Israelites through, I think it's so encouraging to me because it reminds me so much of falling in love with my wife. It reminds me so much of every single relationship you've ever been in, friend or romantic, whatever it is. We don't step in and on the first date, we're not like, oh, hello, nice to meet you, what's your name? Would you like to marry me? Like, we don't do that. We understand that there's a natural progression to things. We understand that there is a season for that awkward, can we hold hands, can we not? What's gonna happen if I hold her hand right now? Like, what's she gonna do? Like, there's a season for the first kiss. There's a season for each piece of it. And I think a lot of times we get stuck in this mindset that we're supposed to have every piece of it right now. Well, here's the reality of it. It says in that scripture that God says, I will send the hornets ahead of you. I will take care of it. That is a prophetic announcement. That's God saying something that was about them, but also that was about the future. And he was speaking of Jesus. Jesus came and Jesus sent the hornets ahead, and Jesus actually went through and Jesus conquered every single nation standing in your path. Every single person that is opposing you, every single situation you're standing against, every single thing that you are lacking peace in, every temptation that you still can't seem to get past, all of it, every single piece of it, every single step in the progression was conquered already by Jesus. Jesus was the hornet that went ahead. And actually, if you begin that chapter and you jump back like 15, 20 verses and you go back, it actually talks about how God said he would send the angel of the Lord, and if you followed the angel of the Lord, it would go well. And that was Jesus. And so my point is very simple. Whatever you're facing, whatever's in your life, whatever you're stuck in, allow yourself the grace to take it one step at a time. Allow yourself the grace of the progression. Because what's so beautiful to me as I pastor these young adults and as I look at their lives is I could literally go down the line right now and I could name off each one of them, and I could name off how I met them. Actually, one that just jumps in my mind right now is Marky. Like, I remember when I met Marky at Circle Church, just an angry, angry little girl. Like, just would not, like, didn't want to play volleyball, like, didn't want to talk, just wanted to, like, hide. And I literally had her, like, I, like, forced her to go play volleyball with some of the girls and to be social, and she wanted, like, nothing to do with it. And I just made her do it and didn't give her a choice. And now I see Marky following Jesus, loving people, serving in the church. Like, I don't care what your thing is. Like, I really genuinely don't. I don't care what you're stuck in. I don't care what you feel like you're never gonna accomplish. I don't care what dream you feel like has been squashed. Dream again. Dream bigger this time. Like, I don't care where you're at. And I don't mean that in the sense that I don't have any compassion. Like, I don't care what your perspective of the situation is. If you will trust and believe that God has a promised land for you, and then if you will just trust him nation by nation, don't go in and try to just conquer the whole land right now all by yourself. But if you would get together through the word, through God's people, through his church, and you would be willing to, I almost just broke my ankle, you would be willing to just nation by nation, situation by situation, thought by thought, temptation by temptation, test by test, conversation by conversation, service by service, altar call by altar call, whatever it is. Like, if you would be willing to allow him to walk you through that progression. step by step and be okay with the slow, grueling grind. Be okay with the slow process, the slow smoothing. Like if you would be okay with one nation at a time, you will find in the course of time that He has driven out every nation before you, and you stand unopposed, and you stand with nothing in your way, and you just get to reap the harvest of a land flowing with milk and honey. Because that's what the Israelites got to step into. They stepped into a land flowing with milk and honey. They stepped into a land that was promised to them. So some of you have never given your life to Jesus, and you're standing at the edge of the Jordan River, and you just need to cross over. You need to first be promised the land. Maybe you have given your life to Jesus. You've received the promise, but you've never actually gotten to that point where you can receive this. I think a lot of time, for me, I'm still receiving this. I think for years I thought that I should just be perfect by now. It's been however many years that I've been a believer. Why am I not perfect yet? And the Lord's really been speaking to me and dealing with me the last few years about being satisfied with the progression. And it doesn't give me a license to sin. That doesn't make sin okay. But I'm going to be okay with being a work in progress and trust that God is working that out in me. And if that's you, trust the process. Trust Him. If you feel like you failed at a nation, that's what they did. There was nations where they didn't do it the way God asked, and they failed. And then they recognized how they failed. They recognized why they failed. And they went back to God. They apologized, they set it straight, and then they went back to battle, and they took the next nation. And that is the process. They didn't ultimately lose until they gave up and stopped being willing to take the nations one by one. That's when they lost the promised land. Don't do that. We gotta be willing to go slow, if that's what it takes, and to allow Him to give us nation by nation. I just wanna thank you guys for listening. I just wanna bless you guys. Just trust the Lord. Trust the process. Trust the process of the promise, because one by one is slow and frustrating sometimes, but it's so worth it in the end. I love you guys. Miss you. We'll be home soon. Be praying for us, please, as we go through this process here, and just continue to be open to what God's going to do while we're here in Cambodia, and come back to you guys soon enough. Love you. Take it easy.